So this material, we've heard, we know that it came from somewhere else, but it really feels like your movie. It doesn't really feel like it's a remake or anything like that. Or
yeah, of course, now since the film is out, everybody knows the two films have nothing to do with each other. So the question of remake has dissipated into thin air. However, what remains is the title, and I always, from first moment on, I said this is a mistake. Uh-huh. It will only lead to misunderstandings. One of the people who misunderstood was Abel Ferrara before, of course, the film was even made. But those are good moments. It's like in a baseball game. It doesn't matter how good the game is or what the score is, but you remember the moments where the manager of a team storms out on the field and yells at the umpire and then steps back and kicks sand at him. So, and Abel Ferrara is quite a character, and yeah, those are these wonderful moments you don't forget easily. But we are in show business, and when I'm in a baseball game, I hope for these moments.
That's
of
when
the umpire
explained.
And the manager yelling at each other.
But it's not unusual for you to go back to material, particularly your own material, historically, and kind of re-envision it, whether as a feature yeah. or a doc.
Yes, but in this case, of course, there's a screenplay which is an entirely and utterly different story and a setup that is completely different.
Right.
So I was attracted by it because of the caliber of the story mm-hmm. and, of course, the possibility that was instantly there to work with Nicolas Cage mm-hmm. and also New Orleans, and I thought it can't get any better. Yes, let's jump into it.
So was it always New Orleans? Was already always
No, Nick? The screenplay was written originally for New York mm-hmm. And I always knew I would like to modify, I would change certain things like the entire beginning, the mm-hmm. end. I invented the iguanas or the alligators. Completely demented sort of stuff in it. And of course, there's also something significant. There were always moments where Nicolas Cage, like in jazz music, like mm-hmm. a musician, one instrument that has complete freedom for a while for mm-hmm. improvisation. And I sensed these moments, and I had one phrase which Nicolas always liked. I said, "You have to turn the pig loose now," or "turn the hog loose." And he knew what I meant, and he goes wild.
You guys do seem like a perfect couple together, in a way.
Yes, I knew it instantly, and he and I had observed each other's work over uh-huh. decades, and we admired each other. And the strange thing is, it never occurred to either one of us to work together. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, at the same time, we had the feeling, this is an outrage. This can't go any longer. And he said to me, within 60 seconds of our first phone call, he said to me, "You know, I'm not going to do this if you are not on board." And I said, "I'm not going to sign my contract if you don't sign." So it was a wonderful platform of trust and respect for each other's work.
And New Orleans, had you already spent any time down there post-Katrina?
No,
or?
I'd never been in New Orleans before. Huh. I had seen, of course, Katrina on television, but I knew it was an ideal case to have a city after its devastation, a city where civility had collapsed. Mm-hmm. And all sense of order and law had somehow disappeared. And that was a perfect place to do it. At the same time, the funny thing was a producer, Avi Lerner, called me almost apologetically and said, "Yeah, Werner, you know, we have to think about money as well." I said, "Sure, we have to think about money." "Yeah, and New Orleans, couldn't it be an option for you? Because we have tax incentives there." And I said, "Avi, it can't get any better, let's go there." Yes. And at the same time, Nicolas Cage wanted to shoot in New Orleans very mm-hmm. badly. He loves the city, he loves the climate of music there. And he said, it's good to be there for the fluidity of a performance. And I immediately understood what he meant.
Well, it seems like a jungle in an urban culture, which
I wouldn't
right
compare.
Your...
No, it's too. it's too superficial to compare it with a jungle. But I know what you mean.
Well, you find that danger in so many of your films, that those places that are, you know, are broken in some way but beautiful in other ways.
Yeah, and I think New Orleans is still, in some areas, it's still dangerous. We shot at a small intersection. And next day I passed by because I wanted to take a few photos of the location. And everything is sealed off because two young men were shot dead on the same place where we shot just 12 hours before. So, what is also remarkable, New Orleans is rising, and there's a sense of bring culture back, bring music back. Mm-hmm. People just came by and shook my hand. Oh, how wonderful that movies are coming into town, and and we love you here. And so I had the feeling, yes, there's a reinvigorating sense, a sense of comeback. And the most astonishing, the police department read the screenplay. And of course, the police department is not seen in a very positive light. And I like their sense of poetry. They said, this is movies. And everybody knows, of course, there was some corruption in the police force, but everybody also knows that a great, great amount of police force responded in a way that only deserves admiration. Let's face it. That was a police force. However, some of them disappeared with the Cadillacs from the dealership.
And you got that spirit.
And the police department had this sense of poetry. And they said, this is movie. Mm-hmm. Yes, and we want movies back, and we want culture back, and we have to nerve to support you.
So did you build a relationship with the city for yourself? I know you famously said LA is a good cultural town, which a lot of people don't agree with, but New Orleans has always been seen as a great cultural city.
Los Angeles as a city with the most substance in terms of culture in the United States. What I'm saying is only the banality of tomorrow. You will see in a few years everybody will talk about it. New Orleans, yes, it's this is music, and it doesn't really look like America, although it is very American. It's almost like a different planet.
Well, we're in LA, we're in a very segregated city. In New Orleans, it really is a cultural melting pot.
Yes. I believe that Los Angeles is not such a segregated place anyway. If you come from Bengal, from India, and you have a great story to tell, you make a wonderful film and which touches a chord with audiences. It doesn't matter whether you are a Bavarian like me, or I have my Bavarian jacket
very nice.
To make a point. Doesn't matter whether you are a Bavarian or from India or from South America, from Mexico. If you have something to offer, they find you, they spot you.
So what is driving you at this point to make your choices? You know, you have such an illustrious history and such a long history, and now you're still making a lot of movies every year. You're going out into the jungles and doing documentaries still. What is driving you at this point?
I don't know. It's number one, let's face it, I love the work that I do. I really love it. And I would be, I think I couldn't exist without cinema. But the other side is, it's not that I ever had a career that I planned. I've just finished a film, let's look into the bestseller list of books. What could I transform, and what could be my next step in my career? I never had a career. It actually, now I finished just 3 films in the last 11 months. I made 2 more films after The Bad Lieutenant. And now I'm sitting here, and already 5-6 new films have invaded my space as almost uninvited guests sometimes. I keep saying it's like like the burglars at in the night, who have you hear something and you wake up at 3 a.m. and you find 5 burglars in your kitchen.
Just demanding that you make
pushing,
them.
Yes. And how do you wrestle them out? How do you cope with them?
So how do you decide when to go ahead and actually start plant the
all
flag?
All is a film that pushes hardest.
So just you that, wait for it to pound harder? Is,
no, I don't wait for it. I'm sorry to say that. They are pounding at me all the time.
Mm-hmm. So is there any difference for you in terms of the experience, in terms of documentary versus a feature film?
No, it's all... You see that there are writers who write novels and also poetry, or mm-hmm. who write novels and short stories, or novels and a theater stage play. Mm-hmm. It's just their profession. It's just what they see. And besides, many of my documentaries are feature films in disguise anyway.
Mm-hmm. Well, a lot
let's
of them
face it.
Number of them become feature films. So Little Dieter becoming
Little Dieter needs
Dawn.
To fly. Yes, there is two. The strange thing, there was always the feature film first. Mm-hmm. However, we didn't have the finances to do it right away. So as there were available funding for doing a documentary, mm-hmm. we did the documentary first, but it was almost done like a feature film.
Right.
Very inventive, very stylized, very poetical, very strange.
Well, you've made your documentaries and your early work from Germany available.
Yes.
Now with on your website.
Yes.
And it's an amazing 6-disc collection, which
yeah,
I grabbed
there's
out quickly.
One, there's 6 DVDs with, I think, 24 of my films that are normally not available on the market or in video stores.
And it's remarkable to see. They're great films.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that you're saying that.
Do you get a sense of there being a new generation that's being turned on to Werner Herzog?
No, I'm stepping into the next generation myself. You see, I've never stood still. It's not that I'm repeating what I did in the late 60s.
Right.
I'm making films. I've completely and comfortably settled in English, shooting a film in English, like Bad mm-hmm. Lieutenant or the last film, My Son, What Have Ye Done? Mm-hmm. You wouldn't notice that a man whose native language is not English has done these films. So, and I'm always out for new horizons, and here, Bad Lieutenant, with a new wonderful star in the movie, new production entities at work with mm-hmm. whom I had never had any contact before. New distribution forms, you just name it. It's just I'm moving.
And you have no fear of distribution changing or formats changing?
No, although we have to acknowledge that there's great turmoil at the moment. The market and the audiences are not what they used to be. Mm-hmm. There are completely new unexplored forms of distribution out there. Mm-hmm. And we don't know exactly where it's going to lead us, but it will settle in. And of course, distribution is in crisis, production mm-hmm. is in crisis. And this is why I keep saying we have to be responsible as directors for the budgets as well. And I insisted that I had a saying in the budget, and mm-hmm. I checked the budget each night. Where are we going? Where are we spending too fast? And mm-hmm. so. And I stayed $2.6 million wow. under budget.
What's the most expensive movie you ever made? I mean, I've named the movie, but what's the biggest budget you've ever even worked
we
on?
We should not speak of the biggest budget, but let's say of the biggest thing that you see on screen, like Fitzcarraldo. It's a film nobody can make under $60 or $80 million.
Yeah.
Nobody. No one. And it doesn't matter how much in reality I spent as my own producer. So. It is a $60-80 million film, although it cost much, 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 much less.
Well, that's my thing, was that you've never been extravagant in spending, even
no,
though your films
it's
have
a
been responsi- giant.
No, because you have to, I had to produce my first 40 films or so myself. Mm. I know the value of money. For doing my first projects when I was 19, actually, the 2.5 previous years, I worked the night shift as a welder in a steel factory in order to earn the money. But during the day, I was in high school. Mm-hmm. So It was tough time, but I know the value of money. And if you bring in a film for a fairly reduced budget, you have a much better chance to become profitable.
Should you even consider at this point your early films like Nosferatu, for instance? Do you think about them at all, or are they just a part of the history and you've moved on to the next thing?
Oh, I'm moving all the time, but of course it's when you have children and they are grown up by now, you never forget them anyway. So, but they have their own life. Let them explore their own life, their own possibilities, their own charm. Let them be as they are. Do not influence, do not repair later on and re-edit a film 30 years later. Just live with it.
Will you revisit that, for instance, for Blu-ray or something like that, do you think?
For
Blu-ray, for the new disc format with higher density? Or?
Well, as I shot on celluloid, the density and the quality of celluloid is always still better than any Blu-ray or whatever,
right,
whatever it gets. It would be only a new scanning of the film.
Right.
But otherwise, the only things that sometimes I try to improve is the quality of sound. Mm-hmm. Because in the late 60s, early 70s, it was just when Dolby started to come into existence. You can do a few things when you're out on Blu-ray.
Right. And now you're ready to teach a new generation at your film school.
The Rogue Film School. For quite long, long, long time, many, many years, more and more young people are seeking me out, and I don't know why, but they see some sort of a sign of hope in me, and and for them I'm a point of orientation, and they are very, very dedicated. I mean, I show a film in New York at, let's say, Film Forum, and the screening is at 8 p.m. and there's a Q&A with me at the end. They line up at 8 in the morning. They line up for 12 hours to, so they, and I thought I should give it a certain form, but it should not be like a film school in the ordinary sense. It should be something like a way of life, a way of experience poetry, a way of being bold, to have courage for your own dreams. So that's what, if you want to learn technical things about how to make a movie, you better apply to your local film school.
Yeah, well, you call for bouncers and sex clubs.
I'm not that interested in whether you have any credentials in movies or in academia. I prefer people who have worked as a bouncer in a sex club, who know how to pick locks, who would like to learn to fabricate your own shooting permit in a country which has a military dictatorship and doesn't want to allow you anything. So I come up and show my own shooting permit in Burma, for example, after the monks' uprising.
Right.
And you do not deal with the generals. I mean, it's the ugliest of all dictatorships on God's wide earth. You do not deal with them, and you shoot anyway. Mm-hmm. And you know who gave me the shooting permit? In Burmese script and Burmese language.
Werner Herzog?
Just look at me. And that's, you have to be ready for that. Be rogue. Be bold enough to do what you have to do.
Your ongoing passion and love for film is obvious and amazing, that you are still as excited, clearly, as you ever were. Are you still a fan of film in other films?
Do you sure, go to see yes, movies? Although I do not see too many films, but you shouldn't forget that I'm acting in movies, and I really enjoy it, like Harmony Korine. What is the title of the film? Julian Donkey Boy, for example,
right,
or others. And I write, I think people here in America discover me suddenly as a writer. I just published also last year, I published Conquest of the Useless. And within 4 months, we are already in the fifth edition of the book. So it's very, very good to see that, because I always had the feeling I was a better writer than filmmaker.
Really?
Well, it's my suspicion. I may be wrong, but I know that in a way, deep inside of my heart, I know that Conquest of the Useless, this book of prose or poetry, will have a longer life than all my films together.
Well, your inner voice, which comes out a lot in your documentaries, in the last number of documentaries, well, really has reached people.
My voice itself,
But you become iconic. And even though, you know, besides being an actor, your way of speaking and your...
Yeah. Well, I have just done a voice, the voice in a film of a very, very talented young American filmmaker whose name is Ramin Bahrami. He's of Iranian descent.
Right.
And he has made a film where I speak the only part, the voice in the film, the voice of a plastic bag. And I've also been cast in a cartoon series for a very young audience, the Boondocks. Well, is it correctly pronounced?
Yeah, but I don't think it's for a young audience.
Whatever.
It's definitely for adults.
Yes, whatever, for
stuff.
Adults, yeah. And a very, very smart screenplay about the election campaign of Barack Obama. Mm-hmm. And I'm playing the part of a German TV anchorman who comes to the Chicago convention and completely naively speaks about, there is Barack Obama and he beat Hillary Clinton and it's really amazing that a Negro has been, and I say this very casual, it's really violent, debased and very viciously written, and I loved it. And
Aaron Magruder, I guess, writes that.
Yeah, they are good people there, yeah.
Very smart.
Yeah.
So in this picture, you went down to New Orleans, you have Nick as the center of your
Can't
universe.
Can't get any better, yes. And Eva Mendes and great other actors.
Do your other actors get to play as much as Nick does? Are they as welcome to kind of let out the hog?
Pardon, is?
Are they as welcome to let out the hog, as you say with Nick?
No, I think it was more for him to... That he had the privilege, and as a central character, to reach out and mushroom out into something completely wild. You can't have a film where everybody is going wild. It would be chaos, and you wouldn't have a storyline anymore. So, but I think every single actor in the film, including the smallest parts. Mm-hmm. You can tell they're at their very best, everyone. Mm-hmm. And that's my profession in a way, to number one, see the potential in someone and guide them along in a way that they can really give their best.
Have you changed as to how you do that functionally?
No, but there's no general rule.
Right.
Of course, I work completely differently with a man like Nicolas Cage, and next to him, Val Kilmer. Mm-hmm. With Val Kilmer, I have a different voice.
Right. And with Eva, I guess.
And of course, yes, with everyone, a different voice. And they all feel safe. You have to give them a complete safety, a platform where they know, here we are, and that's the movie. And from this platform, I can branch out wildly for some moments and come back to where the story flows.
Are you very focused on post-production?
No, it had to go very quick. And I think all the major elements of a movie should not be delegated down the line into post-production.
Right.
People say, we can fix this with the digital effects. We can fix it in post-production. No, you can't. You cannot set the mood of a film in post-production, a climate, a subversive humor. Mm-hmm. You cannot settle that in post-production. Mm-hmm. Or if something is, an actor is out of focus, you can't settle it in post-production. So I think it's a mistake in the industry that more and more they tell, we'll fix it later. No, you should fix it right when you are shooting.
So when you're shooting, once you're done with a film, you have a sense of, you're not really surprised too much by how it comes together.
No, because I only shoot what I need for the screen. I do not cover every angle, and the crews are getting nervous here, and we don't have a video village. You can't see what we shot. Mm-hmm. So they get nervous, but I'm not. I know what I need, and I know this was very good now.
I think you know what you're
and
doing
And I
now,
move
Ron.
On, and this is why I delivered the film 2 days under schedule and $2.6 million under budget.
One of my favorite films of yours is one I've never seen twice, because I saw it at Telluride before Lady of the Assassins. It was a film about self-flagellators. That I think you had Ed Lachman on as the DP, and
which one?
It was about self-flagellators in the church.
That was not
church.
My film, no.
Know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
In Central America, I think, and when you shot
yes,
it.
Yes. I know what you mean, but it was not Ed Lachman who shot it. I only asked him, can I use your name because I shot it?
To me, that's you.
I didn't want to out myself as a cinematographer. However, in Bad Lieutenant, it's the first time that I'm outing myself as a cinematographer of the iguana scenes, iguana and alligator footage by Werner Herzog. It says in the small title.
Your favorite stuff.
It's my favorite stuff, and I must confess, it's the first time I'm outing myself.
And it's such a pleasure. I mean, the movie is such a pleasure. You go to film festivals lately, and it's a lot of heavy, and this movie is very heavy in some ways, but just joyous. People seem to really be thrilled by it.
Yeah, I mean, I've never seen it in my life. Audiences responding so spontaneously and with such intensity.
It's a great deal
of fun. So I'm really pleased.